is one of the middle period, and in the Meno, you end up with this dialogue between Meno, who means unchanging, I think, talking about the nature of virtue. Can it be taught? And the conclusion is that no, it can't. Individuals are born the way they are, and especially if they, you know, if the soul is a character that has lived in previous iterations of life and has the same character. Do you remember those? Well, in the myth of Er, at the very end of this, all the dead are drinking a water that makes them forget. They have amnesia. They don't remember what their previous life was. So when they come back as a new person and wake up, they don't really remember that they've had previous lives and so on. So they're starting again. But here's the interesting impact on knowledge, because we can't learn something new. Instead, what happens is, and here's you've got this interesting paradox here. You know, how can one search for something when they do not know what it is? How did Einstein come up with his ideas? How did Sir Isaac Newton come up with his? How did Eve come up with hers? Eve? Should I have mentioned Eve? You know who Eve is, right? My favorite was Eve's Diary. You ever read Eve's Diary? You didn't know we had Eve's Diary, did you? By the way, you get the idea. Saturday. I am almost a whole day old now. I arrived yesterday. That is as it seems to me, and it must be so, for if there was a day before yesterday, I was not there when it happened. So you get the idea. So if you get the chance, notice it's on Gutenberg. You can go and read it for free. It does point out that the person who found this was a person, an archaeologist named Mark Twain. So it's funny. This is hilarious. I suggest, if you do read this, or if you read the Adams Family Papers, which is Adams' version, wear one of those belts that you're supposed to wear when you do weightlifting, because you could injure yourself. It is hilarious, especially if you read Noah's story about, you know, going back to rescue. Oh, it turned out we only had two male flies. Where's the female fly? We had to go back and find it. Fortunately, it was floating on a dead horse, so we got our female fly. Mark Twain, the reason people win a Mark Twain Award for being funny is because he was funny, and so that's a perfect example of that. But if you go back, let me start closing out some of these. How do you know something? How do these people invent these things? It seems like in order to know anything, you had to already know it, as far as Plato is concerned. And so memory is recollection. So instead of learning something new, what's happening is you're remembering something you used to know, but amnesia made you forget it. And now you're, I remember this. And the example that they use in the Meno is a slave boy who speaks Greek. That's important. And they bring the boy over, and he basically, through a dialogue with Socrates, comes up with the Pythagorean theorem, which is considered pretty high-class mathematics, right? And yet, the boy, without any experience of mathematics, ends up basically answering the questions of Socrates through this interesting method that Socrates uses, which we're supposed to actually use in school today. That's the considered to be the best teaching method, is to use the Socratic method in order to not tell people stuff, but instead ask them questions that lead them to figure out the answers themselves. It's supposed to be much better, much better pedagogy for people, right? To ask them the questions. Of course, the trick is knowing the exact way to ask the question so that you get the right response. Well, so he does this in the Meno, and the boy comes up with basically the Pythagorean theorem, and then they're both pointing out, see, he already knew this. It's just that you needed to ask him the questions for him to come up with it. And so all knowledge in that sense is something that's waiting for the right stimulus to remind you of what this knowledge is. And that's because our minds are connected to the ideal world where all knowledge is permanent. You know, it's like mathematics, you know, and then you go to the ideas, and the ideas are even more this way. And we can't quite be one with the ideas while we're alive because we're in this body, and this body is the prison house of the soul. And the body is corruption. It's corrupting. It's part of the visible world, which you can't really trust. And so, you know, you get lines like, you know, for now, everything is like looking through a glass darkly. But once again, and, you know, once I die and my soul is released from this body, I will be seeing heaven face to face, so to speak, right? You've heard that expression. Paul uses it. St. Paul uses it, for example. But you get others clearly that use it. And it's at least traceable back to Plato. So can virtues be taught? Not really. It's a divine gift. Your character is born with it or not. By the way, for those who were Calvinists, John Calvin was a theologian we really won't touch too much on, but he was a follower of St. Augustine, where this really comes up, the idea that God knowing everything is omniscient, right? Omniscient, right? Knows everything. Omni, all science. Right? Omniscient, right? And so he knows the future. He knows what choices you're going to make. He knows whether you're going to bite the apple or what. And yet at the same time, you get punished because you did bite the apple. And you think, why the heck should I be punished for something God knew I was going to do? He made me that way. Well, that's predestination. You are, from the very beginning, predestined to have a life that will have these many rewards or these many punishments and so on and so forth. And John Calvin is like the theologian who's in Switzerland and Geneva, a contemporary of Martin Luther, you know, so that period. And he gives us the sense that the people who are saved look like it. They act like it. They're the ones that are saved. You're predestined to be saved, and as a result, you'll also be rich. Kind of fun, right? So you end up with an interesting book by Max Weber called, The Protestant... If you're wondering why the Northern Europeans suddenly became world dominant and capitalism was their direction, Max Weber argues that it's pretty much based on this reformation in religion, in Christianity, where people figured, well, you're saved if you look it. You're saved if you have all the wealth. You're a member of the elite. God's elite, if you have all the money and all the trappings of success. So basically, you really got to try to be successful, or you're not really saved. Kind of an interesting thing, but I'll have to quit at that point, I suppose. But next class, we'll go on and start looking at Aristotle, who's going to rebel against Plato. They spent 20 years together, and he's definitely Plato's student. And yet at the same time, he's going to come up with a completely different way of viewing things, which will really be much closer to the way we like to look at things today.
What's the quiz question?
Oh, the quiz question is, do you believe that individuals are born with a particular type of character? Or can your parents actually, like, change you? Can your education change you? Most people say that it's a little bit of both. You start off with kind of the raw potential of a self, but of course, you know, events are going to help, you know, guide that along. Yes. Welcome back. Did we win?
Yes. But I'm going to travel another time this week.
Of course you are.
But the next week I'm here for 10 classes.
Does it help to see everything online?
Yes.
Does that help?
Doing the flights, including your class.
No kidding.
Yeah, because we fly like, we have 3 flights of like 4 hours.
And you didn't catch any filthy diseases while you were flying? You know, like COVID or the flu or... Congratulations. You've got a good...
I already did this quiz.
Because I have it posted. So then you're good.
Okay. So
you can send other. You can still email me if you like. I mean, ask me other questions. Okay.
Bye. Thank you.
And win another one for the Gipper.